Welcome to the Thoughtful Gamer Podcast, episode number 31. Today we are talking about hindered communication. And no, I'm not talking about real-life relationships, but board game relationships in which your communication is hindered.
Are we doing this podcast with only the 2,000 most commonly used English words?
No. I will be sure to use a word that is probably not on that list.
Our communication will not be hindered.
Yes, our communication will be just fine. As always, my name is Marc. Here with me today is Orion.
Hello.
And Matt.
Hi.
We got the regulars, the gang. I have nothing further to say after that. But as I said...
This is where you play the It's Always Sunny intro music, I think.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
The gang talks about board games again.
Oh, man. I'll have to do that sometime on the YouTube thing and get struck down for copyright.
Yep.
But as I said, we're talking about hindered communication games, which is what I am calling the genre that includes games like Codenames and Apples to Apples and Dixit and Deception, Murder in Hong Kong, which the review of which just went up a few days ago. And when I was prepping for this podcast, I ended up writing way more notes than I usually do because as I kept thinking about it, I kept thinking of more and more games that fit into this category.
Well, you conceived this as a versus podcast, right?
Right. So we've done our traditional versus head-to-head contest podcasts, like War of the Ring versus Rebellion is probably our most notable and famous one. And so I conceived, after playing Deception, Murder in Hong Kong, I'm like, oh, this is kind of like Codenames and kind of like Mysterium, so I was going to set it up to compare those three games. And then I just thought of like a dozen other games that would be interesting to talk about. So we broadened our horizons a bit, and we're just going to talk about everything within a set. So let's start with defining our terms a bit, because that's what I like to do, and that makes for a riveting podcast introduction. There are two sets of games that I thought of. So we think of word association games, which is what a game like Codenames falls into, and whose roots go back to old-timey game shows. There's like the password game show, I think.
Oh, yeah.
That was kind of similar. And then I think the $32,000 pyramid or the $64,000 pyramid was similar.
I don't know. I don't remember those.
I don't know. I watched these at like my grandparents' house back in the day because they loved watching the Game Show Network, and that's just full of game shows from the 60s, and they liked word association games. So the idea is that you're trying to get someone to guess a word, and you provide clues using other words to get them to guess that. And pretty much brought to its pinnacle, at least in modern board gaming, with Codenames. But as I was thinking about it, the idea that you're trying to communicate something to another person, but you're kind of arbitrarily blocked from doing that in the most efficient way. And that's kind of, to me, the broader category that's interesting.
Yeah.
Because as I was going through and prepping, you know, I first thought of those three games, and then I thought of the old-time game shows, and then I thought of other games we'll get to soon, and I realized while they all kind of fit under this hindered communication genre umbrella, they end up in many times being vastly different games with vastly different goals. And so that's what I kind of want to break down today. Does that make sense to you guys?
Let's do it.
I'm tracking.
All right. Hopefully everyone else is tracking as well. So we talk about old-timey game shows. There's a whole bunch of kind of what we call classic games that fit under this. Taboo was the one I played a lot as a kid. There's another one that had like an electronic catchphrase which is basically the same thing, right?
Very similar. I think the two games do it differently enough that they kind of have different strengths. Catchphrase's strength was really kind of super low barrier to entry. It was like Taboo, except there are no words you can't say. You just can't say the word.
And don't you like pass it? Isn't it like a hot potato thing?
It's a hot potato thing.
Oh, yeah. That's
and
right. It's hot potato.
Counting down, and there's like a beeper, so it gets really fast at the end. And so you're scrambling for the last clue to try to hand it off.
I do remember
playing
played
that in college a lot.
Yeah.
So with catchphrase, I think the reward of catchphrase is coming up with a clever clue for the word you're presented. But then someone guesses it, and you immediately pass it. But the game itself is pretty random. It's like, if you're the first person to give a clue, the timer's going slow. The timer starts beeping faster and faster. I don't think it's a great game. The reward is more the feeling of giving a good clue when it comes to you. And it's just super low barrier to entry because anyone who can play Hot Potato can play it.
Yeah, and it's interesting because I can't think of any other games other than games that are trying to be literally Hot Potato that utilize that thing, that Hot Potato kind of basis.
The physically handing something around room or a
circle. Well, trying not to be caught with something in a countdown.
Because it's not very strategic, and if you make it strategic, it becomes a bad game.
Maybe. I don't know. I don't think catchphrase is that bad at all. I think it's interesting. It obviously might be a problem with if you have too many people.
So
you got to be able to make it like around the circle at least 1.5-2 times on average to make it interesting.
I always found that it was like there was a border between like 4 to 6 clues that were going to happen. And so, I mean, if you really wanted to win and just didn't care about people having a good time, you would just sit there on the first clue and then give the perfect clue right before, you know, the timer ran out.
Oh, that's true.
You know, yeah, you kind of just, it's like the spirit of the game is that you're trying to give a clue and pass it and keep it moving.
I always had a grand time playing it, but I don't necessarily think it's a great game. I think it's a better experience than it is game. Taboo, I think, is a better game, primarily because it goes back and forth. Your team plays and then the other team plays. So it's
one person from each team giving as many clues as they can in a minute or something.
Exactly. Okay. So I mean, if you get 6, you're just really good.
Yeah.
Yeah. We'll get to that kind of category in a bit because there are a lot of other games that do something similar. I suppose the solution to catchphrase is to make the timing a bit more intricate and have it be like the first person has 15 seconds to do their clue and then they hit it. And it resets, and the next person has 14 seconds, and then 13, and then 12.
That's an awesome idea.
I think that would solve the strategic problem you indicated.
For all I know, there's some kind of algorithm in that thing. It's a black box to me.
Well, I don't think it works. Well, maybe it works that way. I assumed it just had, like, you know, 3 to 5 different total times it rotated randomly.
I never thought to even consider it.
to fix catchphrase?
Yeah.
I think I just solved it. I fixed it, guys. We go home.
You know the other classic game that kind of fits into this is Pictionary.
Yes, I forgot to add that to the list. Pictionary is a classic game that goes on this.
And of course, Matt's favorite version of it, Telephone Pictionary.
Oh, Telephone Pictionary.
And then what's the one that Vlada did? Telestrations?
That word sounds familiar.
Is that Vlada?
Vlada made a game based on Pictionary.
I don't know about
I believe all the clues are very abstract and vague, like time and like nebulous concepts like that to make it frustrating. And there's some other gaminess to it, but yeah, that's a category that'll fit into a category I identified later. But yeah, those are all classic games. And it's interesting now that I'm talking about it, that there's not a whole lot of difference between these classic games and then the modern versions. Like by and large, they're just tweaked a bit from those reference points.
And honestly, the origin story of like Pictionary would be really interesting. Who knows? But it's probably a folk game.
Pictionary, probably. Yeah. Kevin in the chat, one of our patrons, brand new patron actually today. Thank you, Kevin. This has been a delight to have a new person. Just wrote that the Vlada game is called Pictomania. That's right. Okay. I believe Telestrations is just the boxed version of Telephone Pictionary.
Yes.
Pictomania is the Vlada one. Yeah.
Again, it should be noted that Telephone Pictionary or Telestrations isn't much of a game. It's just a really fun time.
It's just hilarious.
It just creates a fun experience. And you have these stories because you have this like absurd chain of clues where, you know, a rock turns into a fire-breathing lizard that then turns into a woman who's doing laundry or something. I don't even know.
Yeah. And while I hate this dichotomy of like game versus experience versus what's the other word people use? Activity.
Yeah.
I think that one might demonstrate it most. That's definitely an activity. There's no way to win or lose.
The enjoyment in Telephone Pictionary is in enjoying everyone's creativity.
Right.
And there are no points. There are no ways to add points to that.
So I guess that Brightline disqualifies it as a game since there's no competitive win-loss aspect or even goal. The goal is the means are the end.
Yes.
So let's try to bring this down. Now we talked about some classic games, some, you know, variations on that. Let's try to identify kind of some subsections of this genre. The first one I'm going to mention, just because I think it's the least interesting, although it does provide a nice frame of reference for talking about where why other games succeed where these don't succeed very well. And this is what I'm calling the apples to apples continuum. Started, I'm pretty sure, by Apples to Apples. I don't think there was one before that that did the same thing. I think Apples to Apples was the actual original game where you have a leader and you have a clue and everyone puts in the clue and the leader picks the winner.
Yeah.
I think that was the first one. And then obviously you get Cards Against Humanity, and as a notable, although I think worse, follow-up on that style. And then probably the other most notable one is Dixit, which does a little bit different things, but they're still like a leader and they still are trying to...
They set a clue, you pick one of them.
Although in Dixit, it's kind of reversed because everyone's voting and the leader's trying to hide their clue amongst everyone else rather than just simply picking the winner. So that one does kind of put a twist on it, I suppose. I don't find that the apples to apple styles games, and there's billion, like there's so many of them, to be that interesting. I think fundamentally because there's so much restriction just by the fact that you have a hand of cards that you have to choose from.
Yeah, so, I mean, first of all my best memories playing Apples to Apples are, like, at Thanksgiving with my aunts and uncles. So, I mean, nothing against my aunts and uncles, but that kind of shows you the level of game. This isn't a gamer's game, obviously.
No, but, I mean, it kind of is.
So,
I mean,
the interesting decision in Apples to Apples is I have these cards, someone's played something, and then you're judging the mood of the judge, right?
Sure.
You're saying of these limited choices and whatever mood the judge is, are they looking for something that's actually relevant or something that's just really funny? Or are they just going to pick the most offensive card no matter what?
Sure.
You're judging kind of the mood of the judge against this limited set of options you have.
That's the other point at which kind of the strict apples to apples follow-ups fail, is because it's very dubious what you're actually trying to communicate, right? It's a hindered communication game, but what are you actually trying to communicate? Are you trying to communicate humor or relevancy or trying to pick up on some kind of inside joke you have with the person? The actual goal each round isn't clearly defined really by the game.
Right.
And that, so yeah, it ends up being kind of ad hoc based on whose turn it is, which in the right situations can be really fun. And I've had a blast with Apples to Apples back in high school, but it's really group contingent in that case because there's not a lot of guidance by the game. And because on the front end, it's so comparatively limiting in how you can give clues.
I mean, the other thing is that, again, super low barrier to entry. You can play with your aunts and uncles. No one's going to be intimidated away from the table.
You can play with your 7-year-old cousin. I mean,
maybe not
Cards Against Humanity, but that's targeting a different audience.
Take that for what it's worth.
Yeah.
Although I do know there is a game that takes the concept and gets rid of the hand of cards, and you can literally do whatever you want, and it's called Say Anything.
Okay.
Because you can say anything. They're very clever with the title. All right, so the next category that I think starts to get a lot more interesting is what I'm calling strict word association. So you're trying to clue someone or a group of people on a word and you use other words to do that. The notable games, we talked about Taboo. We talked about, what's the passy one again?
Catchphrase,
that one. Codenames is
currently
the most popular, and for the foreseeable future, the most popular one, at least in the board gaming world. And then a couple new ones, Crosstalk, which I got to play recently, and then one that just came out that Shut Up and Sit Down just reviewed that we found out earlier today, again from one of our wonderful patrons, called Decrypto. Did you guys read up on how that works?
I listened to the podcast and now I'm blanking on the Shut Up and Sit Down podcast, and now I'm blanking on how it works.
So each side, I want to play this game now, each side has 4 different words selected at random, I assume, and only they can see their words. And they're trying to, and they're labeled 1 through 4, And so you're trying, when you're giving the clue for your team, you're trying to get them to guess three of the four in a particular order. So maybe you're trying to get them to do two, then one, then four.
Okay.
But the other team at any time can guess what the words are.
Okay.
And then you lose, or you're trying to do as many rounds as you can without the other team guessing what your words are.
So when my teammate gives me a clue, I just am trying to figure out the order of the words that I already know.
Correct.
Okay. The other team's trying to figure out what, in a larger superset, your words are.
What the words actually are. So the example Paul gave in the review was that, you know, if one of your words is summer, you might say sunshine, and then it would be super easy for your team to guess that, oh, he means the summer one, but you've just given a huge hint to the other team. So you might associate summer with something a lot more obscure to try to get them off
that's
track.
That's fantastic.
Which seems really fun.
In that, yeah, that balance of trying to create these interesting... I think in general, these games, where they are amazing, is when you're creating unexpected, difficult connections between words.
Right.
And Codenames does it because you're just trying to connect as many words as possible. So Decrypto does it by putting it in direct conflict that you don't want to give too much away.
Yeah, so you can sign it. So with the games like Taboo, Codenames, Crosstalk, and then Decrypto, you can kind of see an evolution of the game mechanism. So in Taboo, the whole point is that there's just a list of words you can't say. And so you can say any words you want. You just can't say these, you know, the most obvious words that would clue them in. So you're working around that. Then in Codenames, you're just trying to get as many words grouped in together, which puts another layer of difficulty in kind of forcing you to be creative with your clues.
And lets you scale the difficulty.
Yeah, lets you push your luck a bit. And there's a little bit of kind of information gained in Codenames by what the other team clues. You might be able to guess better than the other team and say, okay, that one's kind of out of competition for our word. So... you know, there's a little bit of interaction there between opposing teams' clues, potentially. Like at a high level of play, I suppose.
Absolutely. And in some of the best games of Codenames I've played, there is way more strategic thought about that. Like, they gave this clue. I need to stay away from these words. I'll even give a clue that, you know, knocks out a neutral word so that it's easier to make a different association.
Right,
You wait for your opponent to get one of their words, because then it's safe to make a great association.
Oh, I've definitely done that.
And depending on the level of play, all those things come in and out of.
Right, it just depends on the group of people playing and, you know, who the clue giver is and such.
So you see this kind of evolution of designers dealing with the fact that in these kinds of games, the other team can hear you. So in Taboo, they do it just so the other team can kind of referee, right?
Right.
So it adds a little bit of interaction when it's not your turn.
Yeah.
Which you don't have in Catchphrase.
Oh, and it feels so good to buzz the other team.
That's literally the worst thing about Taboo. The stupid buzzer, it makes the most infuriatingly annoying noise on the planet. I hate it.
Oh, it feels so good.
I hate
it so
much. I'm going
to get one of those for the podcast when you say something I don't like.
Oh, no. No. Wait, don't we have a copy of Taboo lying around here somewhere?
We do, but it has the new rubber duck squeaky sound rather than that classic buzz.
Oh, it's the worst buzz. Anyway, so you have that. Then you have Codenames where, you know, listening to your opponent can give you a little bit of information potentially. And then you have Crosstalk, which embraces it fully by the fact that after you give a clue, the other team gets to guess and you're trying to guess over the same word. So that fully embraces this idea of, okay, we got to do something with the fact that the other team can hear you and incorporate that into the game. And then I think Decrypto is even a further step in that direction of saying, okay, now we're really going to make the game about that.
Yeah.
All these games also deal with the problem of the fact that sometimes you just have a really easy clue. So Taboo tries to get around it by just banning the easy clues. In Codenames, just due to the nature of the board, you may have a clue for something really good, but it also might fit in the assassin or one of your opponent's words. And then Crosstalk, you just can't give a good clue because the other team will win. And the same thing in Decrypto. So they kind of kill two birds with one stone here of getting rid of incorporating the other team when it's ostensibly your turn and eliminating the problem of just having really obvious clues you can give.
You know, I don't know where this fits in, but one of the satisfying things to me in all of these games is being able to create a connection with someone on your team. And in some of these later games, that seems even more important, that if you can clue someone, you have a connection with a specific person and you can clue them in a way that no one else is going to know, you have a huge advantage.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you see that as a strength of these, or is that...
I see it potentially as a strength. And later on, we're going to talk about what I'm calling the Hanabi problem and how that can go too far where you create this metagame or this, like, this list of assumptions that you have with another person. But I think in games like this where everything's blown wide open and your clue could be almost any word in the English language, you can't have a lot of that. And when you do have it, it's like a little bit of salt. Like, it adds a lot of fun to the proceedings.
Yeah.
So, you know, after seeing this kind of evolution of mechanisms based around, you know, just trying to eliminate downtime and the idea that you can hear the other team, like, I'm excited to where it goes next. Because I thought Crosstalk was super cool when I played it. And now we got Decrypto, which sounds maybe even better, although none of us have played it yet. And I'm excited to see what the next evolution in this word association genre is going to be.
Yeah, I mean, where do we think it's going to go?
I don't know. That's why I'm excited. Like, I can't see where it goes. Maybe this is kind of the end of the road when we just get variations on this that don't actually kind of progress the idea. But...
Well, okay, here's something interesting. So this whole genre that we're talking about is really siloed, right? Like, there's very little in any of these games that corresponds to any of the other games we play. Is there potential for cross-pollination into, I don't know, I mean, I guess BSG, maybe?
Yeah, that's on the list farther down, a little bit of cross-pollination. Okay. I've thought of an idea, this is on, I hate doing this because it's really half-baked, but I have my list of, like, vague board game ideas I'd like to look into someday that I've mentioned before. And one of them is based on this Isaac Asimov novel called The Gods Themselves, where there's this idea that Earth and this alien planet can communicate through matter transfer. Like,
okay,
some kind of weird matter transfer or energy transfer that changes the nature of the matter slash energy as it portals back and forth. And so I've thought of the idea, what if you took that idea and incorporated it into some kind of Euro game where you have kind of a teammate and you kind of know, or rather, like, you put in inputs and they get something out of it, but you're not quite sure, and they put in inputs and you get some kind of output from it. I don't know. Like, I think you can incorporate that kind of thing into a game. I don't know how you would do it very well, but I think there's a lot of space there for that kind of pseudo cooperation.
Yeah, we're not talking about BSG yet, but the thing that BSG does is there's an interesting game, co-op game, where you're holding a bunch of things at bay and trying to find out information, but there are these points in time where you all come together and do the hidden voting thing.
Sure.
I mean, you could have a game that is a Euro game or whatever, but has these points where you come together and have to convey information in an interesting way.
And I think that's the heart of probably a lot of interesting games, is that you're given a challenge and then you're given some sort of artificial limitation on how you can approach that challenge. So you have to be creative in how you attack it. And there's a balance there of you want it to be an interesting limitation, not just annoyingly arbitrary, and also allow for enough creativity that a skillful player can make a good play and feel good about that because they made a cool, they found a cool clue, or you know, found that, like, perfect association or something.
Right. So I think if we're talking about getting this kind of hindered communication idea into, like, a Euro game, it has to involve some kind of cooperation, or at least like work towards a mutual benefit. And that's because if it was purely competitive, all you would ever be communicating is, I want to win.
Yeah,
right. That's the only thing you would ever want to communicate. And so it doesn't work there. So you have to have some kind of semi-cooperation. And then, as Orion says, open up somehow this avenue for people to be really creative and accomplish something through
alternate paths or alternate win conditions or things like that.
Right, right. Yeah. We'll have to think about this more off
podcast. Yeah, we should probably be having this part of the conversation at the end of the podcast. But
or I mean off podcast and like make a game. Anyway, see, I told you it was a bad idea to get on my list of half-baked ideas.
There's a website called Half-Baked. Did you ever go there? They just had a bunch of half-baked ideas.
What?
Either it was just a website where people would put their half-baked ideas.
Really?
Yeah.
Huh. That's interesting. There's a
lot of uninteresting things and some gems.
Is the idea just like, I don't have the time to pursue this?
I think so, yeah.
So maybe someone else can run with it?
Maybe someone else
did it categorize? It like, can I go there and search by board game?
I think so.
Ooh.
Don't
I still have my million dollar invention idea from years ago. It's the electromagnetic tripod. Did I tell you about this?
No.
So the problem with the tripod, right, is that I'm glad I've created this rule that there can't be too many tangents because I'm gonna go on this. The problem with the tripod is that you have to adjust each leg individually, right? So you set it up and it's like, oh, it's tilted a bit this way, so you got to adjust one of the legs. And it's, oh, it's a little tilted this way, so you adjust one of the other legs if you're trying to get it really level. What if you had a tripod that where each of the legs could just be loosened or tightened with an electromagnet, and you just had a button, and you just set the tripod how you want, like physically hold it there, and the legs just free fall, and you get them all touching the ground, and you get it level, and you just press a button, and it locks in. Be super convenient.
Yeah?
Brilliant. Someone do something with this.
Honestly,
just give me a cut.
I wouldn't mess around with tripod stuff, lest you end up in some kind of War of the Worlds scenario. So you can run with it.
And maybe aiding our alien invaders?
Yeah. I mean,
I'll just keep a vial of flu virus handy.
Yeah, I was going to say, make sure you get your antibiotics ready.
Yeah. Spoiler alert for a 120-year-old book. Oh, all right. Now we got to dig our way back.
Yeah, no, I'm really interested by kind of the evolution framework that you've used.
I think the most interesting thing is that you're giving out a public piece of information and trying to shape it in such a way that it means more to one group of people than the other group of people.
Yeah. So you have to create that divide. And in crosstalk, that's created just by having a private clue. But to crypto, seems like it doesn't have... It kind of does away with that clunkiness, which I thought was the clunkiest part of crosstalk. Matt looks so excited.
Another game idea.
Oh boy, let's hear it.
Based around public and private keys.
Okay.
And you're trying to convey information to random people. Mm-hmm. We need to figure out why you're trying to convey different information to different people at the table at different times. But there's some danger of other people getting your private key, decoding what you're trying to say.
I don't know what this means, but it actually sounds intriguing. A key is just like a decryption, right?
Public-private key encryption is a standard, approach in security in that you have two security keys, and one of them can be used for encoding information, and the other one can be used for decoding the information. And you keep the decoder secret. That's your secret key. You don't tell anyone.
Sure.
But you put your public key out there, so anyone can encode information and send it to you, but you are the only one who can decode it because you are the only one with the private key.
Oh, interesting.
But, I mean, like, in the real world, if attacks, security breaches happen if someone can get a hold of your private key.
Right, which is bad.
And so, I don't know.
Well, motivation, like, you can make up a motivation in a game.
Yeah.
I wonder if you could do a game with cryptography-like stuff. And you're trying to clue people into, like, that's what you're saying, basically, like key,
but
the key to decode the message or whatever.
Yeah, and maybe it's some kind of euro where there are resources, but you have some reason for wanting to convey different information to different people at the table at different times.
Yeah. Well, you could easily have a theme of, like, wartime communications, right?
Yeah, true. Yeah, I mean, even just a war game where cracking the code is a major component.
Maybe, interesting.
Maybe your resource is like supercomputer cycles to crunch, like,
possibilities. Like, or something. I mean, you could set this in the Netrunner world. and it would just fit perfectly thematically.
You just have to anthropomorphize everything into a snake or a cat or a dog or what was the other one? Team whale, team lizard.
I think
there's lots of animal teams.
Team snake and team dog were the top like contenders.
Wasn't it cat?
There was
because you got QPM and.
But like QPM's Rumor like Mill. The only good. Okay, yeah, but
Rumor Mill's not banned anymore.
Oh really?
Yeah, they restricted it.
Okay.
Literally, no one runs it, but. Let's jump to the next category of games that I wanted to talk about, which is just a little offshoot from the strict word association games, and that is what I'm calling beyond word association. That's a vague title, but I couldn't think of anything better. And that's just the games where you're trying to get people to guess a word or a phrase or a name or whatever, and you're using clues other than words. So,
okay.
Charades is the classic example.
Classic.
You're acting it out. And then there are two games. One's called Time's Up, and the other one's called Monikers.
I have Monikers.
You own Monikers? Really?
Yeah, I do.
I think they're pretty much identical games. Actually, I think the full What's name the is Time's one? Up Total Recall.
Yeah. Well, the thing that... Monikers only does two things, really. It gives you the clues. Oh, wait a minute. I'm sorry. Fishbowl.
Fishbowl?
Have you ever played Fishbowl?
Is it basically the same thing as Monikers and Time's Up Total Recall?
Oh, I haven't played the second one.
Or Title. It's not Total Recall. That's a movie. It is
the same thing as Monikers.
It's Time's Up Total Recall. So basically the idea for these, and I think this is how Monikers works, is that you have some clues, you do the first like Taboo style guesswork, and you can use like phrases, and then you throw all the same clues back in, and you do it again, but you can only do one word, and then you do like a charades round, or a facial expression round, or puppets if you wanted, or all kinds of different vaguer and vaguer things, because you gain a deeper and deeper knowledge of what the answers are.
Yeah.
Is that what Fishbowl is too?
Yeah, Fishbowl is the same thing. Monikers throws in like different point values, so they say harder words are worth like 3 instead of 2 or whatever.
Yes, but it's the same thing. And it's all basically saying, hey, let's take word association and mix it with charades and make it zany and wild.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is fun. But they're playing off of the idea that you can just recycle the same clues. So it's just kind of taking that concept and running with it and doing whatever you want with it, which I think is interesting. Although I haven't played one of these games. I might have played what you're calling Fishbowl under a different name at some point. I know I have played like this game.
Kingdoms or something?
I've never heard it called that.
Did we play it in college at some point?
I played it in college.
Maybe I did. I just forgot the name Fishbowl. Is it because you put all the clues in a fishbowl?
That is why.
Did you guys actually have a fishbowl for this use?
I played the version where you were like, you would just like write down a random word and put it in the whatever, and you would draw one and you'd try to like connect, guess which person put that word in or something.
Oh, and that's a different game. I forget what that's called.
And then if you like get it right, they basically stop being an independent player and join your clan or your team, and then you're trying to be the last team standing.
I've never heard of this one.
Oh, okay. Well, There you go.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. I feel like these games all have interesting ideas. I mean, I think Charades is fantastic.
But I mean, I think the Monikers Time's Up thing just makes it strictly better. Like, I love the idea of making it harder, but at the same time easier.
It has another problem, which is that you have two teams and a time limit, and sometimes you can just go through a million clues. The short way of saying it is the first team has an advantage. Because if you get to a round where you can just go through tons of clues,
it puts a limit on the number of clues the second team can do.
Yeah.
Huh.
Or maybe it'll take, you know, 1, 2, 3, but then your team has had 2 goes at it and the other team has...
Oh, interesting. Yeah,
It's not a perfect game. I would say, again, what makes it great is more the enjoyment of the interaction.
Well, I think these games specifically, we talked before about having like in jokes or things that only two specific people understand, you know, personal references or whatever, but it allows the creation of those through the game.
Yeah.
Where someone gives a stupid clue and it sticks, and then everyone uses that moronic clue that doesn't make any sense to an outsider the rest of the game, which I think is hilarious.
That happens every time you play Fishbowl.
Yeah, but I think that's the main highlight of those kinds of games, is you get those really hilarious interactions that then repeat. And then you also get the situations where someone's just stuck, and then everyone else knows what the answer is, and they're just watching them crumble, which you don't really get in other games of that type, because...
You mean like when the other team knows it, but your team doesn't know
it? Like, no, yeah, like literally everyone but the people or person trying to guess it knows the answer.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that kind of situation you don't see a lot in other games. That's kind of unique to this.
I mean, another thing about Fishbowl, I just think the extensibility of, like, you can play where you, the fourth round, where the person is behind a couch and can only use their face, or under a sheet, or whatever.
Right,
that extensibility just pushes that creativity as far as you want it to go.
Sure, which is purely hilarious. The final category, or like subcategory, I thought of was... taking the concept and making it more nebulous, what I'm calling idea association, and this is where Dixit kind of falls into, but specifically Deception, Murder in Hong Kong, and Mysterium, where you're not trying to get the person to guess a word necessarily, but an object or an idea or a concept or a place or something a little bit more vague than a specific word. In Dixit, you're trying to associate a phrase or word with an image. Mysterium takes it a bit further, where you're trying to associate images with other images, which is like doubling the vagueness, which is great. And it recalls the problem I had earlier with Apples to Apples, where you just have a limited set of cards. But because everything is so nebulous and vague and open for interpretation, it kind of breaks through that problem. I'm thinking specifically of Mysterium, that breaks through that problem completely. Because it's just so vague. Everything's so vague.
You could also throw in Codenames Pictures. Ah.
Oh, true. Which I haven't played.
I haven't played yet. You've played it, right?
I played it, and it was good. I don't think it's as good as Codenames, but it was better than I expected it to be. My family loved it, which...
More than regular Codenames?
No, but almost.
Did you ever try mixing?
I think I did once. I don't remember how it went.
That's the enticing thing to me when you have pictures, is
that might
doing
be,
a mix.
That might be good. So, Codename Pictures, I think there's less creativity in the clues you can give, because when you're connecting words with other words, your kind of playing field is the entire English language.
Yeah, and words have multiple meanings and implications and reference
in
points.
Every
yeah.
implication and association that has ever been created that you know about. With pictures, when you're giving the same single word clue, but you're mapping it to pictures, it always ended up going back to, like, these three things have triangles in them, or these three things have
water in them. Because they're all line drawings, right? In pictures?
They are all kind of very simple pencil drawings without a lot of detail, and they all have kind of a surreal aspect where they're kind of two things simultaneously going on.
But it's very clear what they are. So there's like...
Other than the fact that they're two things at once.
Sure.
Yeah. It's very clear.
Yeah. Which is, I think, probably where Mysterium fares better, because you can have multiple interpretations of the same image because it's also fuzzy and vague and
this is
weird.
Probably worth saying up front in these idea association games. It's a problem for the game designer that it lives or dies on the quality of...
The images.
The images that you'll be associating.
Yeah, yeah.
That's one of the great things about Mysterium, is that you get these really vivid, surreal scenes, and you can connect them based on color, or based on, you know, objects, or based on rough shapes, or based on, you know, concepts. There's so many different ways of interpreting these, you know, images.
And it's more than just, it's a surreal image. It has a foreground and a background, and you can interpret individual things differently. Having played Mysterium a lot and loving it, having not played Dixit, I took a look at the Dixit artwork, and honestly, I was not that excited to play simply because the artwork isn't as good.
Oh, really? You don't think it's as good? I thought it was comparable.
I didn't. Of these three games that we've played, I think there's a continuum from Codenames Pictures to Dixit to Mysterium. Dixit is kind of halfway in between of simplicity of image.
Just with how... Yeah, simplicity to complexity of the image. Yeah. In Mysterium, honestly, you couldn't get that much more complex without getting too nebulous and you get, like, abstract expressionism. Like, it's not quite there.
What do you add? At a certain point, diminishing returns.
Right.
What do you really
add? You have to really nail the vagueness versus the ability to kind of latch onto things but not be certain about that those are the same things the other person latched onto, I guess, is the key.
Yeah.
And I think deception is along the same lines of connecting vague clues to objects, but the objects are very cut and dried, and it's sometimes hard to tell what they are because of the physical size of the card, but there's no ambiguity in what the object is.
Right.
So it could almost just as well be a word on those cards.
Yeah, and I think what deception is trying to go for is for the clue giver to be constructing this almost complex narrative about the murder and then try to communicate that narrative. But to do that, they have to kind of play the game worse.
Well, you can come up with a scene, but if no one else gets the same idea, you're just going to be leading them astray, probably.
Right. And if you make Toonie, if you lock into your idea of the scene and try to communicate the scene, which is what I think it's trying to go for, it doesn't. You know, if the people guessing kind of fail to grasp it at first, you have to pivot and then just kind of go item by item and just give the best clue and not necessarily stick to your guns on what the scene was.
Yeah. First of all, we should say the hindrance to communication is that the forensic scientist communicating what the murder weapon and the clue are, they can only communicate in answering these kind of predetermined questions.
Yeah, so it'll be like the physical appearance of the victim, small child, teenager, male, female, senior, and you just pick one of them. Yep. And sometimes they give a lot of information, and sometimes they won't give a lot. But I think to really kind of capture the imagination that the other games do, you have to, as a clue giver, kind of go beyond just saying, okay, this is probably the best clue, but actually just create a narrative in your mind and try to communicate that narrative.
And I mean, I found that to be really interesting.
I think it's all right. I don't think it succeeds spectacularly on any level.
But no,
I don't
think it's not spectacular.
I don't think it fails badly. I think it's just an interesting guessing game.
Yeah, I like... It's cooperative. It's mostly cooperative.
Yeah, the other thing with deception is that there is a traitor who is trying to hide among the other people, which most of these other games don't have.
Yeah, which honestly I think is almost a non-factor in deception.
Unfortunately.
Yeah, unfortunately.
I wish that was a bigger thing. Maybe if we were better at it, it'd be a bigger factor. But
it's no, too I cut think and dry. If we it's were worse at it, honestly.
Yeah,
well,
yeah.
The problem as the murderer is that you can't defend yourself and say no, that's the wrong. You shouldn't make that association. You just have to propose plausible alternatives and hope that other people latch onto them.
And the game provides a way for the clue giver to directly address that in the two follow-up clues.
And there's a lot of randomness in that you have to pick your murder weapon and your item or your clue before you know what information the forensic scientist can give. And so I know a couple of the times we played last time, the murderer picked something and then there was just a perfect clue to say, oh, it's exactly this and this.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
This one is, I think, kind of the outlier. It's kind of unique in the way that information is conveyed.
Well, I think it tries to be unique and kind of fails at it.
Yeah.
Because the most, here are the most interesting things about deception. First of all, trying to analyze, knowing the options that the person had and did not choose is interesting, because that adds another layer of thought into trying to figure out why they picked the clue they give, and the whole process of swapping out one of the clue sheets and adding a new one, because the new one obviously can give information, but the choice of what they tried to swap out can also give information. But those are kind of like little gamey things, and they don't add to the narrative.
Okay, I might say that this doesn't have as much depth, but it's also a shorter game.
True, yeah.
It's fun as the guesser to kind of work out that scene, and in doing so, you're figuring out which clues given kind of apply to what part of what they're trying to convey, right?
Like, oh yeah, like, I don't disagree with that.
And that's kind of
the guessing part of the game is fun. But I'm saying that deliberately compare it to Mysterium, which is, I think, is a very similar game that works better. In that, in Mysterium, you have a similar thing in that if you don't get the right answer, they give you more clues. But I think in Mysterium it fits into the whole thematic context a bit better, where you have more dreams and you know the ghost was listening to you, and the ghost knows that you know that they were listening to you, and you try to give them more information, but it's always within this concept of like vague dreams, which I think it just fits together as a kind of a cohesive thematic experience better than in Deception.
I definitely agree with that. I think Mysterium probably is my favorite of any of these that we're talking about. The kind of clue giving and guessing that Deception gives is pretty fun. I think it's different enough that I could see both being valuable in a game collection.
Yeah, sure. But let's get back to talking a bit more broadly. I wanted to talk about four things that I highlighted, at least, and you guys can pitch in with more if you think of them, of things that these style of games, broadly speaking, hindered communication games, might attempt to accomplish. So in other words, what are the emotions or what are the interesting things that they're trying to do, and how do they accomplish those things? So I think the first one that pretty much all of them try to do is creativity. They try to allow people to be creative. And I know, Matt, you've talked about this a lot, both on and off the podcast, with your love of Codenames and how it allows so much creativity. Looking at all of these different games, I think when you don't have pre-existing limitations on what clues people can give, or don't have a lot of limitations, that's where the creativity kind of shines. Yeah, so even in Mysterium, which we think works really well, it's not, there's obviously some creativity there, but not on the same level as Codenames or Crosstalk, Pictionary,
Charades.
Charades, yeah, all the charade style of games.
Yeah.
And it's like Orion was talking about, that I forget how you phrased it, the sense of accomplishment of encountering a puzzle and figuring out a good clue to give or a good solution to that puzzle.
Oh yeah, when you pull off like a four clue in Codenames, it's amazing. Not only because you probably win the round, but you also just, you got people to think what you were thinking by telling them one word and one number, and that feels great.
Just kind of a comment on all of these games as a whole, because they live and die by the creativity that they're drawing out of people, they vary so much. And like, Codenames is a game for everybody, but for, you know, word nerds, Charades is a game for like hams that may never play another board game.
That's why I like Codenames a lot more than Charades.
Yeah, right?
Yes.
How many times have we played Charades? None. We've never played Charades.
None times.
And where these games shine is how well they allow the player's creativity to come forward. And if we think back to Apples to Apples, or even more so Cards Against Humanity, when they're fun, you're really just enjoying the game designer's creativity.
Yeah, that's a very good point.
Like Helen Keller was like the trump card in Apples to Apples. and sure, like, every group of friends had some really funny moments where someone played that card, made some association that was
completely absurd or offensive or something. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, but the game designer put that card in there. You didn't think of that.
Right, right.
And I think Cards Against Humanity, which I think I've only played once and don't really desire to play again, like, the most offensive thing, like, you didn't come up with that.
Which, speaking of, you know, Cards Against Humanity, that's kind of the point, is that you're offloading the social awkwardness to the designers. Always the thing, like, I didn't actually say that, you know, they put it in there for me, which I think allows them to get away with more offensiveness than you would in a game where you theoretically could think of something that bad. Yeah. Because you wouldn't do it. You wouldn't write it down. Anyways. And I think it's such a cool dynamic when I've seen this in Codenames a lot, where someone's really struggling over a clue and they're thinking, they're like, oh, I've got it. And they give a clue and it's like three or four words and it works out. And at that point, like, even your opponents like share in the joy of someone being able to crack that puzzle, because you know how hard it can be. And it's just, it's really cool to see people overcome a challenge and do well at something. The downside, of course, is when people just aren't good at the game or don't want to put in the effort to come up with, again, I'm thinking of Codenames of like multi-word clues.
Right.
And I have had games of Codenames where people just weren't really into it and they got frustrated and then they ended up giving one or two word clues the whole way through and weren't excited about it.
Yeah. I mean, these games definitely require everyone to be invested. But a lot of these games are easy to get invested in.
True, yeah. And what game doesn't require that, really? I mean, every game requires some level of investment.
On your point, these games, maybe better than any other genre, allow the kind of simultaneous, just like enjoying everyone's success while still keeping the hyper-competitiveness. Like, I want to win Codenames, but I can still have that moment where I am just basking in the glory of my opponent's wonderful clue.
Yeah, yeah. Which is also a function of the games being so short, too. Large.
Absolutely. But I mean, you just think of like a Euro or a war game, and sure, you might admire someone's great play, but ultimately you're pissed off because now they're beating you.
Yeah. I think that's really comes down to, I mean, it's partially the creativity, but partially the length of the game.
Okay, yeah.
I think, because I can think of, you know, we talk about small, shorter Euros like Roll for the Galaxy or Harvest or something. I think,
I don't care what other people are doing.
I know. I feel like if someone tries something bold and succeeds with it, I don't feel as bad as on a three-hour game, because it's like, okay, we can just play again.
But it's maybe a neutral experience. You're not... Sure, there might be some admiration there, but it's not the same as just the like pleasure of enjoying someone's great creativity, I think.
Sure. Yeah, no, I agree. The second thing I think that a lot of these games are going toward is just pure humor and hilarity. And specifically, I think the time restricted ones. So like Monikers or Time's Up or
Taboo or things
Taboo,
like that.
Yeah. Where, because of the time pressure, people can, in the heat of the moment, end up saying something really silly or off the wall or absurd.
And those are the best clues when it works, because you say something completely random and they just like know what you were going for, and it's just like this right angle, but you end up where you're trying to get to.
Yeah, but I think it's interesting because they're just two different sources of joy just by introducing the time element, where if you have the time to think about it, you get more creativity, but if you're in a time pressure, you get more absurdity.
Yeah,
and sure, both of them are great and hilarious and bring everyone together. And I think it's really the time restricted element that shifts the game's goal here.
And I think that kind of the heart of that is seeing how people change and respond under pressure in a low stakes environment, right?
Mm-hmm,
so it's not like you're, you know, staving off the Cuban Missile Crisis and everyone's under a lot of pressure and the stakes are really high. You're just trying to get them to guess some clues, some words, and if you lose, oh well.
Yeah. I think that's a great insight, Marc, because like even in charades, like the fact that the timer is going to go off in a couple of seconds, one, means that you have to do something.
Right.
And two, it means that in a couple of seconds, you're done and it's okay.
Yeah, and it particularly works, I think, in every game of this style I can think of, because the game forces everyone to be in that position also.
Sure.
Everyone has to make a fool of themselves, and therefore, most of the time, everyone's going to have a good time laughing at everyone else. And laughing at themselves, hopefully. The third thing, which kind of fits into all of the ideas I'm talking about here, is that it brings people together. I think these games almost uniquely create a sense of community within the game, either amongst all the players or just your teammates, in that, you know, obviously you're working together, which can create that, but also like in monikers, you know, you might create in jokes during the game, or you might recall back to previous games in one of these and in the silly clue that someone gave, or recall back to some earlier memory you had with that person that provides an interesting clue, or understanding a book reference in Codenames, which has been something where Ben's been like, I don't know if all the people who are answering this have read this book I'm trying to reference, but I think I'll go for it and give the clue. And we're all like, we have no idea what you're talking about, Ben. And I think they're really communal games.
And so you get all this, like, you're kind of, each person has kind of their sliver of deep knowledge that, like, your sister, Matt, knows biology super well. And so she's trying to think of who would get this biology clue and, like, how specific and weird can I be while still getting, you know, that you'll still get it, or that, you know, someone else will, you'll still get it. Or if I used to play these sorts of games with my brother, we'd always have, like, all these in-jokes or just, like, we just would be able to know what the other person was thinking because, you know, we grew up and spent every hour together, you know, for 20 years or whatever. And so it was very easy just to communicate ideas even within that restriction because we have so many shared experiences to reference.
The fundamental thing that I didn't communicate very well earlier is that these games rely not on your understanding of the game, but on your understanding of the people playing the game.
Yes.
Which is
yes.
really unique.
Yes. And it teaches you more about that person because you see the sort of clues they try to give or the way their mind works. And you're like, huh, I would have never connected that. But you did.
It's great fun. Marc, like, I've been on a Codenames team with you a handful of times. And going in, I was like, oh, okay, Marc and I think fairly similarly relative to a lot of people. We're going to be great together. We were awful.
Were we?
Like,
I think Orion and I are pretty good usually.
We claimed to be the dream team and then lost like 4 games in a row.
Oh, that's right. No, I'm just bad at Codenames, I think is what it is. But I'm really bad with Amber. Amber and I never are on the same page.
But like I enjoy that aspect of the community where like you think you're going to be really good with someone and you're just not. Or you don't know that you have a connection to someone going in and then they just know where your mind was going when you give your clue. Sometimes it's about knowing going in, having those connections. Sometimes you find them in the game. Maybe to Orion's point.
Yeah, and kind of just a spin-off of that as another point. All of these games, or nearly all of these games, have an extremely low barrier to entry. So you can play with wide varieties of people, you know, experienced gamers, inexperienced gamers, you know, young people, your family, your random friends that haven't met each other, and you can still have a great time. And it just kind of this idea of bringing different people together from different ways of thinking and different groups or social dynamics or whatever, and it just gives you this kind of platform to communicate in this way and have a great time.
And now that I'm thinking about it, it's kind of a classic comedy setup that you see in tons of comedic works of two people trying to communicate with each other and failing to do so, either because of some contextual thing or...
Like the Marx Brothers, their whole shtick was that the one guy was absurdly literal about everything and the other guy he was mute, and they just were, you know, they had these crazy scenes where they're talking around each other, and it's just, you know, it's hilarious.
Yeah, or you think of, like, double entendres, or who's on first, right? The classic comedy thing. Like, that is a situation that will never end in comedy. Like, that's just a fundamental comedic premise.
Because it's relatable to everyone.
Yeah.
We all try to communicate or have to communicate with other people every day, and we know a little bit or maybe a lot about the struggles of that. And so then you're put in this situation and you either watch other people fail or you see how they can be creative. And it's either hilarious or extremely satisfying or both.
Right. And to go even deeper and more serious in this, you know, it goes back to this idea generally of comedy being just the other side of the coin is tragedy, where interpersonal relations, oftentimes, almost always, if there's a problem there, it's a problem with communication. So, you know, maybe that's the reason that becomes such great fodder for comedy, is that we oftentimes laugh about tragic things to help us kind of psychologically get past it and understand it deeper. And now we have a whole game genre about this. This stuff was not in my notes, but I think it's really cool. Another classic comedy thing that I just thought of because Amber was watching Arrested Development recently is Tobias's constant misunderstanding of what he's communicating throughout that show.
Right. Which comes up in Codenames. Like 10 seconds.
Yes.
10 seconds after you've given a clue, you look at the board and you're like, oh crap.
Oh yeah.
I made a huge mistake.
All right. The fourth and final, I guess, goal or thing, I don't have a good word for this, that these games accomplish, I think, almost inherently in this style of game is suspense. Because there's always the time period between the giving of the clue and the answering of, you know, trying to get the answer for that, that's suspenseful. Like, it's just an inherently suspenseful situation. And sometimes it's the suspense kind of goes throughout the whole game. And the games where you're trying to, like, rack up a lot of points, like in Taboo, it's, oh, can they keep this going? In something like Codenames or Mysterium, it's, oh, man, do they understand what I just said or what I just clued? And are they going to get it? And that harrowing, you know, moments before they actually give an answer, which Codenames beautifully exploits by the rule that you have to physically touch the card.
Yeah,
like that's just perfect psychology of you have to lock it in physically.
Yeah, and the moment as the clue giver of you're hearing your team discussing your clue and you have to be blank faced and they're just like completely on a wrong track and they're just circling the assassin. And you're just praying that they come to their senses and think of what you were
maybe
going
for. Maybe
they're
on the exact right track, but they're
then they talk themselves
really
off
hard to talk themselves away from it.
Yeah, yeah. Well, which going back to kind of the cinematic or literary idea, that's irony, right?
Sure.
When you know something, and maybe in a play or a movie or whatever, and the audience knows something, but another group of people doesn't know something, that's an ironic, dramatic situation. And that's what these games really exploit. To me, that's almost the best part of these games. Like, in my review of Mysterium, I think I talked about how being the ghost is the most wonderful kind of torture in board gaming or something like that.
Yeah, and Mysterium might nail the suspense better than any of these. I mean, Codenames is great, and I think Codenames nails the creativity better.
But Mysterium is so vague that...
Well, yeah, it's gone. Part of it is the dread that you don't think you could have done better. You know it's a mediocre clue.
Oh, yeah,
but it's
that's
the
good.
Best you could have done. And now
they don't know that because they don't know what you had in your hand.
Yeah, and now you have to sit there knowing that while they discuss it.
Yeah. Well, and also the stakes are really high in Mysterium because it's a longer game than most of these. And you can only fail, each individual guesser can only fail like four times. They have to get three correct answers in seven attempts maximum.
And each correct answer puts them in a new category, so no information can be saved.
Right, yeah. So it's really high stakes, or at least it feels more high stakes in Mysterium, I think, than in any of the other examples. All right, the final thing I had here is just what I'm calling oddities. So these are games that have similar ideas, but they're mixed in with either a bigger game or they function slightly differently that they didn't fit into the other categories I created. And the first one that I immediately couldn't categorize is Hanabi. And I think it's not because it can't be fit into one of the other categories I had before. I don't remember which one, but just because Hanabi has a very specific problem that, to my mind, makes it a pretty mediocre game, and that is that it really encourages anti-creativity and the creation of a very strict meta. So the idea with Hanabi is that you're giving clues either in a very limited set. So you either say, you pointed, you know, cards in someone else's hand, and you say, these are the same numbers, so these are fours, or you point out all the same of one color. And those are the only kinds of clues you can give. And you're trying to communicate information along the lines of that you should play this card or you should discard this card. That's basically it. So it's super limited. And to be good at Hanabi, to get a high score in Hanabi, you kind of create this metagame system of communication that takes away all of the potential for creativity. You want to be very regulated and know exactly what the other person is communicating. At which point the game kind of dies.
Yeah, and it dies, well, because everything is just kind of predetermined. And the other thing it does is it makes doing the wrong thing just feel bad, because you have that one person at the table that misunderstands the meta a little bit. It doesn't do the clue that everyone else wants, and then you're just sitting around there grimacing. Whereas other games, that potential for failure is endearing and is something that we laugh at and enjoy.
Yeah, and when I was thinking about this, I'm like, there's nothing stopping you from doing something similar in all these other games, of creating kind of standardized, okay, this clue means this, other than the fact that the possibility space is so huge that why would you do that?
Yeah, it's just Hanabi, you're conveying limited information, but the clue space is so small
that it's very easy to create these rules.
Yeah, whereas these word games, you're so restricted in how much you can say, but the connection space is infinite.
Right, yeah. So I think that's where Hanabi fits, and I think it's kind of... It's something we'll talk about with another example later, or a couple other examples.
I've really enjoyed playing Hanabi, but it's been like in these short stints of I play it three times with one group of friends while camping.
And then you take like a 6-month break.
Exactly.
Yeah. That's how you have to do it.
And it's like this fun puzzle that you play in line or you play camping and then you've played it out for a year.
Which is fine. It works and that's a clever idea, but you know, it's got that problem, which led me to think of another game, which was just nominated for the Spiel des Jahres, The Mind, which I don't think you guys have played. Have I told you about this game?
Oh, I think I heard of it, but I can't remember.
Okay, here's how it works. Ready? The whole game is a deck of cards, 1 through 100.
Oh.
Everyone's dealt a certain number. It's an increasing number. So at first, everyone's dealt 1 card each, then 2 cards each.
I Googled The Mind and it was not helpful.
And in each round, collectively, you have to lay down cards in ascending order and you cannot communicate at all. You cannot talk. You cannot gesture. The only kind of communication you can give is not communicating. So if if everyone has 2 cards in hand and you have like a 15, you kind of wait there a second. You're like, you're thinking, man, by this point, if someone had blow a 15, would they have played by now? And then you go for it. And then you just keep doing that over and over, which it's a clever concept. But like, even when I was taught the game and learned it, the guy had to be like, okay, I've seen this happen in other groups. You cannot like create an internal collective timer and like in rhythm.
Yeah.
And it's like, I was like, oh, it's the Hanabi problem all over again.
Yeah.
You have to really fight against creating that metagame to make the game work, which just means that you're foregoing an obvious way of playing the game better to make the game actually function, which is a bit of a downer. I would certainly play The Mind again, but I think it's another example where you have the Hanabi problem.
Yeah, I've had fun playing Hanabi, and I think part of the reason that it has stayed fun for me is that I refuse mentally to codify those sorts of meta. One part is that I play with different people, and another is I just look at the numbers and say, that seems like a good clue, I'll give that, and not try to develop an idea of, first you tell people about the fives, and then you tell people about the next card to play, and then you tell people when to disc, or something like
that. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I just,
which you have to do.
Well, if you're trying to get a perfect 25, you maybe...
Like, well, no, I was saying you have to like force yourself play the game effectively, suboptimally.
Well...
To remain within like the spirit of the rules, which I think is... I guess I'm repeating myself, but the point is that it's a bummer of like... game design that you have to create this.
Yeah,
you have to have this meta built into conversation the
game to prevent you from doing that.
Yeah, I hope The Mind doesn't win the Spiel.
Hanabi
won the Spiel, but I think it should be done now. No more Hanabi problem games winning the Spiel.
Yeah, again, when I'm thinking about The Mind, it has the Hanabi problem that I'm talking about earlier, where if someone screws up, that feels bad, which
Well, and I should say, in the mind, there's a whole system. There are two other mitigating factors. So you have a certain number of lives, and every time you pass through a round of the game, you either gain a new life, basically, a new, you know, forgiveness for a mistake, or the shuriken card, which the group can agree to play at any point, and it forces everyone to discard their lowest numbered card. There's a little bit more there to help things out, but yeah. Moving down to some other games where there's hindered communication built into the game, we mentioned this before, Battlestar Galactica, which we just played the other night. Its earlier, younger, worse cousin, Shadows Over Camelot, which have this semi-cooperative thing and rules codified in the actual rulebook that hinder communication. So in right. Shadows Over Camelot, you're not supposed to say, in both games, you're not supposed to say the numbers of the cards you have.
And that's in Gloomhaven as well.
Oh, that's true. In Gloomhaven also, yeah.
But it doesn't feel as significant in Gloomhaven because there's so many other things going on.
Yeah, the stakes aren't super high for that.
Yeah.
And if you play with a team, you kind of learn the numbers.
And honestly, the game wouldn't be that much worse if you just said the numbers. It'd make the game a bit easier.
Yeah.
Like a hair.
Yeah.
But you have, again, the Hanabi problem, particularly, I think, with Shadows Over Camelot, because all of the cards are 1 through 5, and you want to be playing very specific cards.
Yeah.
Whereas in Battlestar Galactica, you're more trying to play within a range of numbers rather than a specific number.
Yeah, when I'm sitting there in Shadows Over Camelot trying to figure out what to play, like, it's just frustrating that I can't say my numbers.
Well, what happens is you have, I want a middle sword, or I want a middle but slightly longer sword, yeah. And you end up saying the numbers otherwise.
In Battlestar Galactica, it's not frustrating that I don't know exactly, because I think it's obscured better to the point where
it fits into the theme of there's a crisis and you don't know exactly what the other person is doing.
But just as far as the numbers go and the like, the total number that you have to hit, it's kind of too complicated.
Well, it's within a range, right? So in Shadows, if you need to play a 4, you need to pass a 4, you have to pass exactly a 4.
Yeah.
In Battlestar Galactica, you're trying to reach, you know, a threshold of like 15 on something.
Yeah. So,
and
if someone plays
a 2 or 3, it doesn't really matter as long as you know it's just a little bit.
And in Battlestar, the traitor has a lot more interesting plays of they can play too much and waste cards effectively, or they can say I'm unable to help, or they can play cards that would be useful in other situations, or play subop. I mean, there's just more room for deception and intrigue there mm-hmm. than Shadows.
Yeah. And then the final game that I wanted to mention, which I think is a very interesting implementation of hindered communication, is Memoir 44 with the Overlord game. And Memoir 44 normally is just a two-player war game, really light war game, where you're playing cards out of your hand that specify either a specific type of unit or most commonly a specific segment, which is split into thirds, of the map that where you can activate your units. With the Overlord game, where you get two copies of it and you make a huge map, ideally you have one person over each general third of the map. So each person gets two segments of the normal map boards,
right?
Because now there are 6 total. And then you have someone who's like the general. And all they do is distribute cards to the people in charge of the smaller sections. But according to the rules, and I think it's really brilliant, they can only talk to one of their commanders. So
they
give cards to everyone.
But they can only communicate plans with one person.
They can only vocalize plans with one of them. So that means with the other two people, they have to try to communicate just by the selection of card they gave, which, you know, maybe it's really obvious. Oh, he wants me to activate those troops. Or maybe you get it and you're like, what on earth does he want me to do? I thought those troops were in a great position and don't need to be moved or activated. Or you're like, maybe he just got rid of this card just to cycle through his hand because the general's doing the whole hand cycling thing where they're trying to keep a flexible hand to respond to different threats across the board. And the one time we played Overlord, that aspect of the game worked so much better than I thought it would, because, you know, you have to have the general person be kind of the better player at Memoir for it to work best. But in that case, I think we did kind of have that a bit.
You at least need an experienced
player. You need an experienced player, yeah. And I don't know, it just worked really well, because frequently in that game, you know, I passed a card to someone and they're like, I have no idea what to do with this, and I couldn't talk to them. And I'm and I'm just sitting there like, no, those two troops, you need to activate those two troops and move them to this spot, and it'll be perfect.
Of everything we've talked about, this one is interesting to me because it emulates real life.
Yeah, logistical challenges of communication in a pre-satellite era.
Right, yeah. Your general can only be on one field of the battle.
Yeah, and they're sending physical letters to the other field, or, you know, something like that. And I think it's a really cool implementation of this hindered communication idea into a larger game, which you don't see a whole lot. So the final thing I want to wrap up with is just this idea of a metagame, in that in many games, when you create a metagame or a metagame develops, it makes the game richer. But I don't necessarily think that's the case with this style of game. Because we talk specifically with the Hanabi problem. And obviously the games that work best are the games that have so much openness or so much variety that they make it very hard for that to develop. So the game retains its spontaneity.
I think some of that is that in a lot of other games, like, you know, the Resistance most notably, that when there is a metagame, people become more predictable, and then subverting the metagame becomes very interesting and very beneficial. Mm-hmm. Whereas in a game like Hanabi, subverting the metagame just ruins experience for everyone.
Yeah, which it's just playing poorly.
Yeah.
Or just making a bad move.
In other games, subverting the metagame can be the creative option. And
sure,
in a
Euro, right, where you might be balancing, like, everyone kind of goes for these things, and
right,
then there's
if
a
there's
balance,
an accepted valuation.
If you can go in an unexpected direction, you can find a place to get ahead.
Right. And we talked about this in a lot of Euro games. Doing what other people aren't doing is often a good strategy.
Yeah.
And figuring out how to do that is obviously a challenge. But the metagame and having a shifting metagame makes those games more interesting, because it's another facet of your decision making that makes the game richer, as you said.
And in these hindered communication games, I think I didn't think about it for each specific game, but I can't think of an example where a metagame, like a strong metagame being developed, actually helps the game.
No.
The thing is, a strong metagame adds information, and the whole point of these games is to have limited communication.
Yeah.
And having a fixed metagame gives you an additional communication outside of the strict rules of the
game. But a lot of them, there's nothing to be gained. Like Codenames, there's nothing that you could gain. I mean, what would a meta be in Codenames? Just like giving certain types of clues?
Something like giving clues left to right.
Yeah, but I think that's strictly against the rules also in Codenames. Yeah.
And that's one of the reasons why Codenames is such a good game, I think.
Yeah.
I could see something like very situational metas, like you decide to cycle cards in a certain way that becomes obvious.
Yeah, but some of them it's not going to really happen.
I think it's more an issue in the Hanabi problem games, as you mentioned.
Sure.
Yeah.
But I thought that was an odd thing that came to my mind, that these kind of function the opposite of most games in that regard.
The meta in Resistance is such a huge part of the game. Interestingly, it's not nearly as big a deal in Battlestar Galactica. I'm not sure we ever developed a meta. I mean, we played it less, but I don't think we ever developed big things that carried over game to game.
We have some like subtle
a little
things.
Bit.
Things like the way we talk about our cards, and things like executive orders being accepted as a usually superior option, and some of that is just looking for efficiency in action, you know, action efficiency. But
yeah.
You're right. It's not in the same way as Resistance.
Yeah, maybe if you played it, you know, 20 times in a row or something, it would happen.
There could be subtle things.
There's a lot more other stuff going on that kind of distracts you, I think.
Exactly. And yeah. I think that says a lot about the design of Battlestar Galactica.
That's everything I wanted to talk about. I think There's a lot of takeaways from this podcast. I don't want to repeat them all. A new one, or kind of new one, that really fascinates me after this discussion is that I am so excited to see what kind of innovations we're going to see in these kinds of games, or incorporating this idea into other games in the future, because I think there's a lot of really interesting, unique dynamics that come to play with hindered communication situations that can help other games, but it's also a difficult design challenge. So
yeah.
I think we will probably see it incorporate into games more. I don't know at a higher rate, but we're going to see games that do it in the future, and I'm excited to see if they do it really well, and if so, how they do it. Like, I think it's a really cool design space to explore, and I want other people mostly to explore that.
I wonder if you could see new games that incorporate different sorts of technology or concepts that we use in technology, like security or, you know, hashing or blockchain, you know, those sorts of structures that we use in technology, what you can maybe make a more analog version of them to play a game with, and then subvert that or limit that in some way to create a puzzle.
Well, I think that's the game we need to make, and other people can make those other games that I can't think of.
The Thoughtful Gamer is now on the blockchain.
No! Wait, is that good or bad? I don't know what that means.
It depends who you ask.
Yep.
It'll either solve all of your problems, or it'll lose you a lot of money.
Cool.
Yeah, right.
Anyway, that's our podcast for today. Thanks for listening, everybody. Don't forget to check out thethoughtfulgamer.com for all kinds of reviews and articles and good stuff there. Hit me up on social media. Let me know what you thought of this podcast. Honestly, I think this might be one of my favorite podcasts we've ever done. So maybe I need to continue writing. Wow. I love this conversation.
It's great, great stuff. I agree.
Yeah, and it was the most notes I've ever done to prep for a podcast, so maybe I need to prep better.
No comment.
No one's ever told me to do that before.
That's a lie.
Anyways, let me know what you thought of the podcast on social media. If you want to watch the recording live and get all the juicy stuff that I edit out of the podcast, it's
so juicy.
It's the juiciest of stuff. Go to patreon.com/thethoughtfulgamer and help us out financially, and you can watch all of our podcast recordings live, and more importantly, receive my thanks for helping us out. Also, if you enjoyed this podcast, go to iTunes or wherever you listen to podcasts from and rate and review us, because that helps us out somehow with algorithms and other technical stuff that I also don't know that much about.
You're going to have to learn about algorithms if you're going to get on the blockchain.
No, not algorithms. Algorithms is just a fun word to say. Like, it's meaty. It's a woody word. It's a woody word. Algorithm.
Rhythm, yeah. Is woody.
When it's got the nice woody prefix, al. Algorithm.
Algorithm.
Anyway, that's the end of the podcast. Goodbye, everybody.